Once again, thank you for having me here. And I want to talk to you this afternoon, just a little message that God dropped in my heart one afternoon, and I wrote it down, called Stay in Your Own Lane. You know, if you think about driving a car, if you drift out of your lane, you're likely to get in a wreck or cause a wreck. And our lives are the same way. We need to know what our lane is and get in it and stay in it. And you know, when you find out what your sweet spot is, or what it is that you're supposed to be doing, what you're gifted for and talented for, the devil will use any number of ways to try to get you out of it. And one of the things that happens is we begin to compare ourselves with other people, and maybe we're not doing what they're doing, and maybe it looks like what they're doing is more important, or it's better than what we're doing, and so we fall into the trap. And I think everybody probably does this at least once in their life. For some people, it's a lifetime problem of trying to be something that they're not. We think that we should be like this one or like that one. We should look like you or act like you or behave like you or be able to do what you do. And not only do we think that, but a huge mistake that human beings make is they think if they're good at something, that everybody else should be good at that too. Come on now. How many of you get frustrated at other people you're in relationship with because they can't do it as fast as you do it, or the way you do it, or they can't do it at all? Maybe it's your children. Maybe it's somebody that you're married to. And we, in a marriage, you fall in love almost always with somebody that's different than you. And then as soon as you get married to them, you start trying to change them and make them like you are. And that's such a mistake, because the reason why we're drawn to people that are not like us is because we need them. We have certain gifts, other people have certain gifts, and the way God wants his body to work is for each of us to bring what we have and work together without comparison or without thinking that our job determines our worth and value. Now I'm going to say that again. Your job, your career, does not determine your worth and value. Amen? We have to stop looking at somebody and thinking because they seem to have what the world would deem as a more important job. And notice I said what the world would deem as a more important job, that makes that person more important than them or better than them. The only thing that we need to do is find out what God wants us to do and do it, and we will get an equal reward. If I'm on the platform because that's where God has given me the grace to be, and people listen to me speak, or if I'm a great singer, which I'm not, but there were people up here before me that were, and maybe then there's somebody else here that their job is to stay here after all this is over and clean the place up, maybe clean up the restrooms after us and sweep the place up, people tend to think, well, I'm just a janitor. Or I hate to hear a woman say, I'm just a stay-at-home mom. Let me tell you, the minute you say that, well, I'm just this, you're already saying that you're lowering yourself or what you think of yourself. And I'll tell you what. I mean, I remember being home with three kids. And I'll tell you what, that's not just in anything. I mean, that can turn you every which way but loose. And it's a big job. You're not just a stay-at-home mom. My gosh, you're a mother. You're taking care of, women take care of so many things. And they are so valuable and so such multitaskers. And they have tender hearts and they care about things. And so one of my goals today is I want everybody to go out of here today feeling good about yourself. And I want everybody to go out of here knowing that you don't have any reason or right to compare yourself with anybody else. And if you're doing this, I want you to stop comparing yourself with other people. You don't need to look like them, act like them, know what they know, do what they do. You need to just be you. And you don't need to apologize for being you. You need to be yourself because everybody else is already taken. Amen? So, if you get out of your lane and you're trying to run somebody else's race, you're going to sure end up with a wreck in your life. And I can tell you there are people sitting in here today and people listening and watching on different devices, and the only reason why you're unhappy is because you're trying to be something you're not. I mean, that is the only reason. And you're doing it for all the wrong reasons, because you think you're supposed to, because people tell you you should, you ought to. It's amazing. Everybody that does something thinks everybody else ought to do it. But that's not the way it should be. You know, I used to sit in church and think, oh man, I wish I could sing like her. Boy, she's got such a beautiful, I just wish that I could sing like her. And you know, God taught me a lesson. He said, you know, I put gifts in other people for you to enjoy, not for you to be jealous of. Now, I have a gift of communication, and I'm going to be able to communicate some things to you today about the Word of God that's going to help you understand it in a better way. So all you need to do is sit there and enjoy my gift. My gift causes me to have to work, but you get to enjoy it. And see, your gift causes you to have to work, but then I get to enjoy it. And I can tell you, before God can do very much with you, you're going to have to come to terms with and get comfortable being yourself. Amen? You can't want to be, I want to be just like you, or I'm going to be the next Joyce Meyer. Well, I hope not. I mean, I hope there's only one of me, and whatever you do, I hope it's greater than anything that I've done. Don't settle for being like somebody else. Be the best version of yourself that you can be. And stop apologizing for yourself. Amen? Do what you're good at. Don't be afraid to just do what you're good at. I don't know. Do we really believe God wants us to be happy? Do you really think He's going to force you into a career that's going to make you miserable? Wonder how many people keep a job they hate just because they make a little more money than they would make if they took the job they'd really love to do. Come on, I'm going to say that again real slow. Do you know how many people hate their job? I hate my job. I hate my boss. I hate the people I work with. I hate the drive to work. God doesn't want us to hate our lives and hate what we do. So you say, well, then why don't you get a different job? Why don't you do something else? Well, you know, I can't afford to give up the money. I make good money. I'll tell you something, joy is a lot more important than money. Now, obviously we need money, but you'd be better off to find a way to cut your expenses and get a job where you can be happy than to spend your whole life doing something that you hate and dread. And I hope that I push somebody over the edge today and you just get enough guts to just quit that job you can't stand. I mean it. Don't spend your whole life doing something you can't stand. We should love our lives and we should enjoy our lives. And you can't do that if you're trying to be something other than what you are. God always gives us grace for our place. So many people don't seem to know what they're supposed to do with themselves in life. I just don't know what I'm called to do. You know, if you really don't know what you're called to do, just try a few things. And just find what you're comfortable with. Find what you enjoy. Find what you're good at. You know, when I fell in love with Jesus, I just wanted to serve God. I just wanted to work for Him and do whatever I could do. And I was willing to try anything. I never was one of these kind of people that spent half my life waiting for God to tell me what I was called to do. I just got busy, and if the church had a evangelism team and they wanted us to go out, and the church I went to had a big street ministry in downtown St. Louis, and they had this big thing about passing out tracts. I'll never forget those tracts. They were white and yellow and had a little Jesus loves you smiley face on them. And we would go into downtown St. Louis and give these tracts to strangers and say Jesus loves you. And I hated it. You say, well, what kind of a thing is that to say that you hated giving out gospel tracts? I hated it. It was embarrassing. I had to make myself do it. I didn't like it. And we went in the winter and it was freezing cold. And I remember the first tract I tried to give to somebody, they slapped it out of my hand and said, I don't want that blankety blank blank thing. But then there's other people that are really anointed for that kind of evangelism. And I mean, you don't, if you're a sinner, you don't want to get in an elevator with them because you'll be saved by the time you get out. I tried door-to-door evangelism, and that was all I did was go door-to-door, and I let everybody else do all the talking. But you get me up here, you can put me in front of 20 million people, and I'll be just as bold as I can be and say anything I believe God wants me to say. So why could you get in front of 20 million people and talk, but you don't want to face down one person? I don't know. And what's more, I don't care. All I know is God's got everything covered, and we don't have to all do everything. We just need to find out what we're good at and do that. And just because somebody else is comfortable doing that doesn't mean there's something wrong with me or something wrong with you because we don't want to do that. Are you there? I bet somebody just got set free. And so then, and I did the street thing for a long time, and I just didn't enjoy it. I dreaded it coming. It just wasn't me. And then, of course, I felt guilty because I didn't like it. You know, I felt like I should like it. I should want to do it. And I think sometimes as leaders, although we may not even realize what we're doing, they pushed that so hard at the church that I went to at that time about passing out these gospel tracts everywhere you went. I got to the point where I didn't even want to go out of the house because I felt like that all I could do was face strangers and try to give them a gospel tract. I guess you're all bold and none of that would bother you, right? You just love to do that. And so then I tried working in the nursery. They needed nursery workers. And it took about 2 weeks, and me and the babies both knew I wasn't called to do that. Come on. But then I got this idea that I was going to get this group of women together, and in one summer we were going to put gospel tracts on cars and parking lots. And so I got a handful of women together because I'm a natural leader and I can motivate people to do things. And in just a couple of months, we put 10,000 gospel tracts under windshields on cars. And then I got called in before the elders of the church and got in trouble because I did it without getting their permission. Now, that's sometimes how religious hierarchy works. They're going to stand and tell you what you ought to be doing, but then if you try to do what you feel comfortable doing or what you're called to do, then you get in trouble because you didn't get somebody's permission to go do it. Come on. I won't be back until July. You'll have to forgive me by then. So as leaders, we need to help people. We need to not force them to do what we want them to do, but we need to help them find what they're comfortable and gifted and anointed to do. And by the way, that's your job as a parent too. Train up a child in the way they should go, according to their individual gift or bent, the Amplified Bible says. Not try to fulfill your unfulfilled dreams through them and make them do what you never got a chance to do. Get in your own lane and stay there. Enjoy your life. You know, Jesus said that he died that we might have and enjoy our lives. I mean, that turned my world upside down when I saw that many, many, many years ago. We're not just here to make it through till Jesus comes back. We're supposed to enjoy this, enjoy our journey, enjoy everything that we do. Even Adam and Eve were told to enjoy all the food in the garden. We're supposed to enjoy one another. Enjoy the life that God tried to give us. Romans 12, 3 through 8. For by the grace given unto me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned to him. Now, this is a good message in itself because it's saying, okay, whatever gift you have, whatever grace God has given you to do what you do, don't make the mistake of thinking more highly of yourself than you ought to by thinking that it's you doing it. Because it's not you doing it, it's God doing it through you. That's exactly why no matter what we do, our who is what's important. It's who we are in Christ, and everybody in Christ is equal no matter what you do or don't do. Amen? And if you don't realize that what you're good at because God has enabled you and gifted you to be good at it, you will fall into that trap of thinking that everybody else should be able to do what you do. Anybody know what I mean? Do you ever have anybody that's just gotten aggravated with you because you couldn't do what they do? Yeah, come on. I'm going to find somebody to talk to in here. Yeah. Can you imagine how it must mess a kid up if they have a parent who is constantly railing on them because that kid can't do what they do or what that parent thinks they should do? Or the worst thing, comparing your kids with each other. Well, why can't you be like your sister? Why aren't you as smart as your brother? Don't ever compare your kids with one another. Matter of fact, go to the other extreme of telling them you're not supposed to be alike. God's created us all uniquely different. Come on, I hated myself for too many years and I finally got over it and I want to help you get over it too. For as in one body we have many members and the members do not all have the same function. No matter how bad you want to, you just can't do everything that everybody else can do. Thank you. That must mean you need this. I can just feel that some of you uptight people Come on. We don't come to church to impress each other. Let me tell you something. As long as you feel the need to impress somebody, you are never free. Never free. You're only free when you can be completely what God has gifted you to be, not apologize for it, not compare yourself, and I don't need to try to impress you. That's why I can enjoy what I'm doing and just love you. And I really just feel in my bones that somebody is just going to get a breakthrough today. That I mean, you're going to get it. I'm okay. I am okay. There is nothing wrong with me because I am not you. There's nothing wrong with me because I weigh 10 more pounds than you do, and no matter what I do, I can't lose it. Don't you love those people who forget to eat? I may forget a lot of things, but I never forget to eat. Amen? One person can cut soda out of their diet and lose 50 pounds, and somebody else can live on bread and water and gain weight. Pressing on. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another, having gifts that differ. Everybody shout out, I'm different. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. And let me just say this. You can have 10 people that have the same gift, but the strength of that gift may be different in each one. You may have 10 people that have a lovely voice, but one who just is really just like stands out. You have one pastor that can pastor a church of 300, and then you have somebody else that can minister to the whole world. And boy, we get ourselves in trouble. Every preacher thinks they should be on TV. Well, I can just tell you. If you are not called, I'll never forget when we were thinking about going on television, we went to some guy that was speaking at the same conference we were, and he had a television ministry, and I so much wanted to talk to him and see if he could give us a little advice about going on TV, and you know what he said? I advise you not to do it. If you think you get judged and criticized with your 50 employees you work with, you ought to try being in front of the world. You got to get over some people not liking you real quick. I mean, there's always a bunch that do, but there's always going to be some that don't. I mean, you wouldn't believe some of the stuff that people crab about. Your earrings were too long and they distracted me. You know, Your earrings were too sparkly and it bothered me. Well, you're going to be really uncomfortable in heaven where the whole thing is gold and diamonds and jewels. And probably if I wasn't bothering you, somebody else would anyway. So go ahead and just take it out on me. I just feel like just being a little feisty this afternoon. If your gift is service, then serve. I have the gift of helps, but it's not in helping other people, it's in getting them to help me. Now, I can help people like this. Spiritually preaching, I love this, but if you make a mess, I'm not going to be the first one to go grab something to clean it up. But I'll tell somebody else to get something and clean it up. Hey, I don't apologize for what I am. That's not the gift God gave me. I tried for a while to clean my pastor's house, and I hated it. I was just trying to impress him. I didn't really want to clean his house. Oh, it feels so good to just tell the truth, doesn't it? If you're a teacher, then give yourself to your teaching. And I love this part of these verses. It says, whatever your gift is, come on, give yourself to it. Come on, whatever your gift is, give yourself to it. In other words, focus on that. Why do we keep trying to be good at things we're not good at? You know, if you're a 2 at something, you can struggle all your life and maybe become a 4. But if you're an 8 at something, you can focus on that and work with God, and you can become a 10 real quick. The way to stand out is not to be halfway, maybe a little bit decent at 20 things, but it's to take 2 or 3 things that you're really gifted for and pour yourself into that and become outstanding at those things. You don't have to do what everybody else does. You don't have to do what everybody else does. If you're an exhorter, then give yourself to your exhortation. You know, Mike is our staff pastor. Mike, stand up a minute just so they know who we're talking about. He's our, we got enough employees, we got to pastor them. Because, you know, Christian people are not all perfect, and believe it or not, they can argue, and, you know. So Mike's in charge of, what do we call it? Conflict. Mike's in charge of conflict resolution. And he's good at it. But now, Mike knows the name of every person in our building. He probably knows all their families' names. I run into people sometimes somewhere, and they'll say, hi, I work for you. Oh, how long have you worked for me? 12 years. And I don't know. And you say, well, that sounds terrible. Well, I don't have the gift of running around the building. That's not my gift. My gift is to pray and preach and study and write and get these messages and do. Will you just get happy doing what God has called you to do? Oh, I better behave. Some of you are looking at me funny. Come on, just admit it. Don't you just get tired of the pressure? Does anybody just get tired of the pressure? You know what? Every pastor's wife doesn't have to play the piano and lead the ladies' group at church. And every woman doesn't have to like to cook. I know you know. Wow. Boy, guys, I think I just ruined your meals. You know who Darlene Check is. Most of the world knows who Darlene is. She says to me, don't you just love to cook in your off time? And I'm like, no. Why would I want to do that? I tried it once. I mean, I used to cook all the time when my kids were little. I mean, I cooked big meal every night, packed lunches, cooked breakfast, but I've been there, done that, I'm done with that. Amen. Hey, but if you're good at it, I'll take yours. What are you good at? What do you enjoy? God will not call you to a career that makes you miserable. If you try to do something that you're not gifted at, it will only frustrate you. And you'll forfeit your peace and your joy. And you know what else you'll do? You'll make the other people that you're in relationship with unhappy. Because if you're unhappy, it comes out of you and gets off on other people. And I think a lot of times when people are doing what they're not really gifted for and they're unhappy, they always look for something around them to blame it on. Yeah, it's good. It's good. Yeah, I don't know. If you've watched me very much, you've heard some of my stories, but I can't help it. I just gotta. Because this is just, when I look back, I think, how dumb can you be and still breathe? You know, I had a big call on my life. I felt like when God called me, he told me I was going to go all around the world and preach the gospel. And which sounded stupid. I mean, I was somebody from nowhere with a broken past and a 12th grade education, barely passed English, and I think I'm going to preach to the world. And so for 5 years, I taught home Bible study, and then God said, "Behold, I do a new thing." Don't you love those words from God? "Behold, I do a new thing." So I quit the Bible study, laid that down, thinking, now I'm going to the world. And so for the next year, I did nothing. It was like God just set me on a shelf. And it was one of the biggest testing years in my life. But you know, really, when I look back, you live life forward, you understand it backwards. When I look back, I understand now that it was that year in my life that God taught me that I had to stop trying to be like somebody else. God was not going to let me into the ministry that he had for me if I was not going to get up here and not try to be Kenneth Copeland or Marilyn Hickey or somebody else, but if I would just be me. God doesn't want a bunch of clones of everybody else. He wants a fresh approach. Amen. But I had a lovely neighbor who just could do so many things that I couldn't do. She played guitar. I tried to learn to play guitar. My fingers are too short. It just doesn't work. Besides which, I came next to English, I came very close to failing music. So that wasn't good. I can play a harmonica a little bit, and I played a kazoo once in a church play. That's as far as it goes with me. But she was Susie Homemaker, I mean, to the max. She growed stuff in her garden, she canned tomatoes, she made jelly, you know, she made her kids' clothes and made a lot of her own clothes, and just, she mowed the lawn, she painted the house, she macrameed plants, I mean, she just did it all. And I just wanted to tell everybody what to do. That was my gift. Let me tell you what to do. So during that year when God wasn't letting me do anything, she talked me into doing a bunch of this stuff that she did. She talked me into trying to grow tomatoes and can tomatoes with her. And so I talked Dave into digging up a garden and she thought I should learn how to sew, so we got me a sewing machine. I went to some sewing classes. Anybody remember stretch and sew? Anybody? All right, there's a few people that are old as me, and you remember stretch and sew. And it was just like this real stretchy material, and so I made Dave a pair of shorts. It took me forever. I made him a pair of shorts. They were gray and had black piping on them, and when I got finished with them, the pockets were longer than the shorts. And then when you made mistakes, you sat with this little picker thing and you had to pick out one stitch at a time. I hated that sewing machine. I hated it all. I hated that garden, but I was trying to be the right kind of woman. Come on, because I just did not fit the mold. I wasn't what women are supposed to be. My pastor's wife was a beautiful, sweet, little submissive blonde that just adored her husband. did everything he told her to. And I'm like, I ain't doing that. I don't feel like doing that. Do it yourself. Now, wait a minute. I'm not saying I was right. I had to learn some things too, but no matter how much I learned, I'd never be like her. But I honestly tried to lower my voice. I mean, I did this. I had this garden, I had the sewing machine. I tried to talk softer and sweeter. Yes, honey. And behind the scenes, I'm thinking, you guys act like this is comedy hour. I want you to learn something. Are you learning anything? Well, the tomatoes came in. We had our canning equipment. I bought all this canning equipment. Woo, we're going to can tomatoes. So I went out the harvesting day, and some bugs had come through and ate big holes in all my tomatoes. I mean, crop was ruined. I called her and I said, oh my gosh, some bugs have come in and eaten holes in all of our tomatoes. She ran out in her yard and checked and called me back. She said, my tomatoes are fine. Well, I got mad. I said, God, I prayed over my tomatoes. And I don't even know if she was spiritual enough to pray over her tomatoes. I mean, I cast devils off my tomatoes. I prayed on my tomatoes. And now they have these big holes in them. They're ruined. And you know what God said to me? I didn't tell you to grow tomatoes. I have no responsibility to protect your tomatoes. Come on now. So maybe you're trying to do something and it's just not working and not working and not working. Is anybody home in the house today? It's just not working and not working, and you cannot understand why it's not working. Well, wake up and smell the roses. Maybe God is opposing you. All right. Now, I've learned how to be a submissive wife. Dave, stand up and shake your head. Am I not a submissive wife? Nah, don't do that. What? Am I a submissive wife? Yes, I am a submissive wife. If you want to eat ever again, I am a submissive wife. Dave and I have so much fun together. You know why? Because he just loves me just the way I am. But I mean, I am absolutely serious when I tell you that I had to go through that before God could use me. That's the serious part of it. As long as you're trying to be something you're not, God cannot really use you. He has something that he wants to use you for, but you've got to be willing to be yourself. And if that means being different than everybody else, then you've got to be willing to do that. And if that means you get judged and criticized, then you've got to be willing to do that. Let me tell you something. When Jesus showed up on the scene, he was very different than anything they had ever seen before. And he brought a revolution. He brought revelation that turned the spiritual world upside down, and things have never been the same since. Amen? Now, what does that thing say? Oh, don't tell me it says 1 minute. What is that, 4 minutes? Oh, Lord, have mercy. Okay. One other thing. Oh, jiminy Christmas. Okay, listen. 1 Corinthians 12. The body does not consist of one member, but many. If the foot says, because I'm not a hand, I refuse to be part of the body. Would that make it any less a part of the body? Our body has to cooperate together, just like we're supposed to cooperate together. Do you know that I cannot get my shoes on if my hand refuses to help? I tried to think about it today, and it would be impossible for me to get this boot off when I go home if my hand is just checked out and said, I'm not doing it. I don't want to be a hand anymore. I want to be a foot. And see, really, this whole analogy he's giving, which I can't do justice in the little bit of time I have, but the whole analogy that he's giving is that when we are jealous of one another and we try to be something we're not, then nothing functions right. One quick example that God gave me a long time ago. Let's just say that my eye, I got a really nice ring that somebody gave me years ago. And especially when I get my nails done, I always do that. It's pretty, see? Well, what if one day my eye said, you know what, I'm sick of looking at that ring. I want my own ring. I don't want to just look at the hand's ring, I want my own ring. Well, what if God said, okay, we want you to be a happy little Christian, so here you go. Have yourself a ring. Okay, now. Well, now listen. You can laugh later. I got what I wanted. But now I can't do anything else I'm supposed to do. Now I've crippled myself from being able to do what I'm really supposed to do, but I got what I wanted. And I think a lot of times God just gets tired of hearing us and he gives us what we say we want just to prove to us that it's not really what we wanted after all. Come on, give God a praise. Okay, listen. Because I got into this and I'm not real sure how to get out of it, I'm going to turn the service over to Lisa and let her come and give you an opportunity to receive Christ as your Savior. And I thank you for putting up with me. I had a good time this afternoon. Did you get anything out of it? Amen. All right. Love you all very much. I'll see you in July.
Oh, my word. Give her a good hand clap as she leaves. And Dave, too. Dave, we love you. Amazing. You can be seated for just a moment. I want to remind you, bye-bye. Love y'all. I want to remind you, please stay in your seats if you can. This is a very serious time, and we want to give everyone an opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. Let's bow our heads in prayer just a moment. It'll just be 5 minutes. If you'd say, Lisa, I have never accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. If I die today, I don't know where I'd spend eternity. I don't have peace with God, but I want to pray the salvation prayer. Raise your hand right now. Amen. Raise your hand all over. Thank you. Thank you. If you're here and you say, Lisa, I have been away from God, but I want to return to Him and serve Him with all my heart, I want you to raise your hand. In fact, all of you, just stand up who are raising your hands. You want to pray this salvation prayer. Give them a hand clap as they stand. God bless you, sir. Those who raise their hands up here, God bless you. Please stand up. The usher has something to give you. My brother Joel has written a book that will help you. Does anyone else need to stand? I don't want to rush this moment. Someone else, I feel like you need to stand. You need to receive Jesus. You need to rededicate your life to the Lord. Please stand up. Please stand up if that's you. Thank you. Thank you. Let's pray this prayer together. Say, Dear God, I know I'm a sinner. I'm in need of a Savior. And I come to you today. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins. Jesus, come into my life. I want you to be my Lord and Savior. I receive forgiveness. And I thank you that I am now a child of God. I have been born again. I'm new on the inside. And I commit that I will serve you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name. Now look at me, everyone that you stood up, you are new on the inside. Your sins have been forgiven. Listen to this. Your sins have been removed from you. You don't have that sin nature anymore. You have the nature of God inside of you. And you just take that little book that Joel gave you, read it. Listen, come back to see us. We love you. We want to pray with you. We want to help you grow in the things of God. And bring your friends back when you come too, because you will get stronger. Give us a year of your life, and you will never be the same. Amen. Give them a good hand clap. Let's all stand. We love you all so much. Thank you for coming. We'll see you this Wednesday or next weekend. Bye-bye.
Thank you for making Lakewood Church a part of your weekend. My name is Terry Williams, and I'm going to share with you some exciting things that are coming up here at Lakewood Church. Pastor Joel, Victoria, and our Lakewood Church team are going to be on the road in Fort Lauderdale, Florida this Friday, February 8th, for a Night of Hope in the BB&T Center. If you've never been to a Night of Hope, it's a lot like the Lakewood service you just enjoyed. Visit joelosteen.com/events for more information on schedule and tickets. We encourage you to invite some family, friends, and attend a Night of Hope when it's in your area. Lakewood Music's new album is here in the Lakewood Bookstore, anywhere music is sold, and on all streaming platforms. It's called Live in the Wonderful. It's got great songs like Etched, Let It Be Known, and my personal favorite, Surrounding. Check out our website at lakewoodchurch.com to get more information on the many events we have here year-round at Lakewood Church. If you've never been baptized in water, we encourage you to come on out. February 9th, you can take the next step in your faith walk. Our pastor, Joel Osteen, will be water baptizing here at Lakewood Church. Now, you do have to sign up, but registration is really easy. Simply go to lakewoodchurch.com/baptism to register to be water baptized. If you have a heart for medicine or missions, we encourage you to come out February 22nd and 23rd for our M3 Global Medical Missions Conference. You'll hear from leading doctors and missionaries on how you can be most impactful in areas like human trafficking, water sanitation, hygiene, and so much more. Our M3 Conference is a place for you to find your mission and impact the world. Serving the local church is something near and dear to my heart. As co-director of the volunteer teams here at Lakewood Church, I can tell you firsthand, there's a place for everybody to serve. If you want to connect with other people and make a difference, join the team. You can simply text the word TEAM, T-E-A-M, to 77377 to get a volunteer application sent right to your smartphone device. We hope you enjoyed this week's service, and we want to thank you again for making Lakewood Church a part of your weekend. Listen, I encourage you to come out and be a part of a service. It's incredible to be able to watch it online or to listen via Sirius XM satellite radio, but there's nothing like being in the room with about 10,000 people just going after it in an incredible moment of worship. As Pastor Joel says, come on out. We'll make sure you feel right at home.